Blackstone Publishing presents The Witches of Eileanan by Kate Forsyth. This book is read by Elle Newlands. The Test of Fire. The Red Guards lifted their claymores and began to run towards them. The witches were in very real danger, for if they were taken, they would be burnt to death. Megan gripped Isabeau's arm.
Use the flame as a weapon, she said. Now, Isabeau!
Instinctively, Isabeau threw a great ball of flame and was shocked to the core when soldiers fell screaming. Shaking with an inner chill, she threw another and another. George huddled by her side, not even trying to protect himself, as arrows rained towards them from the crossbowmen. Isabeau spun to see the soldiers very close now, the mesmered hovering right behind them, rearing up against the billowing clouds. It was more than 7 feet tall, with a face of inhuman beauty, and huge gauze wings. Its clusters of eyes shimmered with iridescent light. Isabeau found her gaze being drawn irresistibly to those huge glittering eyes, and her fire faltered and dropped.
"Dinno look at it!" Megan shouted. "Dinno let it breathe on ye!"
With a shriek, Isabeau scrambled backwards, slipping and falling. The first strand is drawn. Isabeau the Foundling. Isabeau swung her pack over her shoulder and strode down the track, her eyes roaming over the ground as she searched for the first unfurling of leaf and flower through the muddy snow. It was only a few weeks till Candlemas and the beginning of spring. And since it was the first fine day in months, Isabeau had spent all day digging and cutting, filling her herb bag with roots, leaves, and early flowers. Although the sun on her neck was warm, snow still glittered on the jagged peaks above her and lay piled in the shadows below the massive trees. It had been a bitter winter, and Isabeau was glad to be out in the meadows again, breathing deeply of the sweet air and calling the creatures of the valley to her. Animals of all kinds were stirring as the sap flowed again in the stem, and they gambolled about her feet or twittered to her from the bushes, tempting her to lay down her spade and knife and play with them. She smiled and spoke to them in their own language, but did not stop, knowing she was tired and the light already fading. She must be home before nightfall. Although the hidden valley was almost impossible to find by chance, these mountains were dangerous. The valley's teeming life temptation to hungry hunters, whether human, beast, or fairy. The path led down through the trunks of ancient towering trees. Through the entwined branches came glimpses of the rocky finger of Dragonclaw, rearing above the lesser mountains around it, its narrow tip dusted with snow. Isabeau paused at the crest of the hill, stretching her aching back and enjoying the spectacular view. The lake below her stretched toward the eastern rim of the valley bowl, coiled over the edge, and fell hundreds of feet to the valleys below. Above the far distant hills, the two moons were rising. Magnus in bronze in the sunset sky, Gladriel lavender. There was a faint tang of smoke to the air, and Isabeau stepped forward eagerly, realizing her guardian must have returned while she was out in the meadows. Megan had been away for several weeks now, and Isabeau had begun to wonder whether she would return in time for her 16th birthday, only 2 days away. Reaching the base of one of the massive trees that stood around the lake, Isabeau tucked her spade more securely into her belt and began to climb swiftly and easily. Soon she was 40 feet off the ground and reaching out for the gossamer ropes that hung between the branches, almost invisible in the twilight air. She swung out of the tree's branches and into the next, hands clinging to the ropes that formed a bridge from trunk to trunk. As always, she cursed her guardian's obsession with secrecy, which was what made the entry in and out of their home so difficult.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.